throat and talking in our accents and reading the whole film. He said, "We've got to understand that we have an American audience." He said, "I don't care about the Europeans, they can defend their audience themselves." But he said, "We have to have less accents, so we all had to dump the picture when we came back."
So you,
every single thing we did, we had to dump.
Originally, you spoke in a much thicker accent.
Oh, I was off. No. Charles Rapidly tell. He had too much manners to let me know that. But his, I overheard his little man say, "Well, oh, she wasn't this dog's James, really, not a dog." So I made a point to be really extra good, to be a bit extra authentic, or authentic, I should say. And after the first scene I had with James, he came over to me and he said, "You know, you're not bad."
Is he a difficult man?
He wasn't. He wasn't easy, but he got the best out of it because he was a perfectionist. And of course, we all know what a great actor he was. So he brought me up. I really did this film for him to prove to him that I was an actress after all.
In the novel, which is a wonderful novel,
yes,
I'm such a good writer, but your character doesn't exist.
I know, I know.
It was all men, it was Hans, and the relationships were different.
Yes.
But this makes your presence gives it more of a dynamic, more of a conflict. It improves some curiosity.
It is a conflict. And the conflict comes to a point at which time I want to leave. But my character isn't there, so I have to stay.
But that's Charles Bradley.
Yes, yes.
And I was saying before, he only wrote The Sunset Boulevard and Lost Weekend. He was sort of a good writer.
He was a wonderful writer and a fabulous human being. He really was a terrific guy to know.
Now, did he add Gertrude Hyman? Gertrude is not into his work either.
No.
It doesn't matter. I was just as happy as the Gertrude show was to be exactly the same. It works for the film.
It certainly works. And everybody, all the people that, you know, when I first saw this film after I made it, we had a premiere in Hollywood, and I was sitting next to some young girls who were crying after they found out that Gertrude was no more. Feathers here, and when they saw the first feather, it was like they joined in a chorus of, they got it. And then they didn't really have to show the skin and the rest of the feathers. They understood what had happened. Oh, we had a ball. And you know that it was my idea to, because it looked like he was looking around for something to drink, and I had this cup and I was drinking it. And it's water and the sea, it wasn't in the script. I gave him part of my drinking water, as you can see on the screen, but it was a gesture just from me to Gertrude. I quite really
appreciate it. It wasn't an improvised moment.
It was a good
That's very good. Yes. We'll come back to film. I just want to go back before we just a little bit. Started off on the stage, actually.
Yes. Mr. Strauss goes to Boston. There's a musical about Johann Strauss. Well, Jack Warner saw me at the opening at the Century Theater in New York, and because I'd always wanted to be a musical comedy actress, I had no idea of going to Hollywood at all. And he came backstage and he said, "I thought you were wonderful, but I didn't like anything else. And I would like you to move to the West Coast to make a screen test." And I said, "Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Warner. I didn't believe it was a real Jack Warner." So I thought it was a good play. And I said, "I'm sorry, Mr. Warner, but I have a wonderful play contract." And he said, "Well, never mind, dear." He said, "This is not going past 14 performances." His part, and he was right. It opened after 14 performances. It broke my heart, but I didn't.
Anyway, from Warner's to MGM.
Yes.
Films like Three Little Words, Staring Red Skeleton.
Right.
And you were at MGM at the height of its glory.
Oh, I was at the end of the golden era. I mean, the movie stars were real stars. Seeing them on a big screen like this is never a little screen. And it was a magical time.